So this section of the course is the one where I save my what's a good word for it? Broader comments. This is the section I save my broader comments for. I'm still young and I'm still working on piecing things together. Perhaps I'll never be done, but I think everything I've said thus far can be fairly well cited and checked, and it's in the quote unquote formal science. I like to make a few suppositions and suggestions based on my intuition and patterns I've noticed here, and I will do so. But I really like to talk about the people I call the seminal thinkers, the elders, people who have pushed the envelope, and just about every single person here is putting forth understanding that is, again, in the formal Western scientific structure, but seems to argue towards a broader understanding of the nature of things. I go back and forth on whether I need to justify bringing these topics up or not. I try occasionally to find relevance and as it pertains to growing crops and growing plants, but I really do think the more open and coherent our own understandings are and our own beings are, the more well we are able to deal with life, to deal with plants, to deal with nature, and the more integrated our beings are, the better results we're going to get when we work with nature. I think nature reads our energy and responds accordingly, and so not that I'm justifying myself, but you'll maybe soon see that I'm bringing forth some topics which are fairly out of the normal conversation. Before I go too far down the path, I'll start with a review of some basic sciences. From the perspective of biology, we have assumptions among microbiologists. There's something around 1.5 million species of soil fungi, something around 3 million species of soil bacteria. Of course, we don't really know, because all the microbiologists and all the decades and all this, languages that there's been microbiologists have come up with names for somewhere between 3 and 5% of them. I made reference to this yesterday, that something between 95 and 97% of the species of life that exist in the soil, the species, like cow, chicken, rabbit, cucumber, right? 95 to 97% of the species don't even have names yet. In science, in Western science, we are deeply ignorant, profoundly ignorant about what's going on immediately below our feet. And yet we understand, it seems, that it is these people down here who are the ones that are feeding our plants. And that's the other point I want to emphasize, or the major one in this slide, is that this science seems to be pretty categorical, that actually it is the life in the soil that is feeding the plant. And when the life in the soil is not flourishing, and the life on the leaf surface as well, and when that life is not flourishing, we should not expect our plant to be flourishing. This is a thoroughly different analysis than you learn in conventional agronomy. It's a foundationally different sort of mode of understanding, and I call it the biological perspective, the biological system, the biological understanding, life. I think, I started off by laying this out at the beginning of the morning yesterday, and I said, if you're not okay with this, you might as well walk out now. I'll give you a refund, because this is the foundational insight upon which the whole presentation is grounded. It's interesting when you have conversations with people about soil and about fertility and about gardening and about farming, that oftentimes their assumptions about what's right and what's wrong go back to precepts that are based on chemistry, not on biology. People talk about liming. They talk about putting N, P, and K down. They talk about, pounds of N and all this kind of stuff. And that whole mentality is founded on the precept that the plant eats soluble nutrients that are in the water, because it doesn't have a gut to digest its food for it. that whole conversation is founded on this central precept, which I think is fraudulent. I think we can argue is fraudulent, as at least it's not how nature evolved it. It may work as a IV drip works, but it is not how nature evolved it. And so oftentimes people who take this course and get impassioned about such topics attempt to convey these ideas to other people and find that there's like they're speaking not to each other but across each other. And I think this central precept about it's the life and the soil that is the plant is feeding, that is feeding the plant, is the foundational point to convey. And once that point is understood and agreed upon, then the rest of the argument can be conveyed and understood. So for whatever it's worth, I'd like to just review that and touch on that before concluding. We understand the importance of our gut flora. We understand the importance of colostrum and inoculation. These are the central points about biology that I want to just reiterate. So chemistry, I haven't talked about enzyme systems. I haven't talked about human health and degenerative diseases and all that kind of stuff. So let me use this chemistry slide to touch on those topics. I sometimes address them earlier in the presentation, but it hasn't happened this time. In chemistry, we talk about a few, there's a number of things, but we're talking about the nature of the elements and the structure of the elements. In chemistry, it is understood that every element has a certain size, like one atom of copper is 1.5 angstroms across. An angstrom is a unit of measure, it doesn't really matter how big it is. It's not, copper may not be 1.5 angstroms, but the point is, zinc is 2 angstroms, and cobalt is 1.7 angstroms. Every element has a certain actual size. And also, every element, when it's bonding with other elements, like we talked about vitamin B12, when cobalt is bonding with amino acids, it bonds in a certain geometry. Think about a pyramid shape versus a cube shape versus a soccer ball shape. We've got tetrahedrons, we've got octahedrons, we've got icosahedrons. Think about a Tinker Toys. Anybody ever played with Tinker Toys long ago? Maybe occasionally, recently, if you've got grandchildren or something. I have children, so I play with my children. The Tinker Toys, you've got this, you've got the one wooden piece that's got a shape with holes drilled into it, and you put the stick in, and then based on where the holes are drilled, the sticks are going to go out in a certain angle. That's like the bonding geometry of copper versus the bonding geometry of zinc. One has, they have different shapes, different bonding geometries, which determine the shape of the compounds that they make. And this is foundational when it comes to enzymes, which are a critical biochemical compound. And let me just talk about enzymes for a second. We've talked about hoop houses a little bit here in the past couple of days. I told you that I've got 8 hoop houses, which means that I built hoop houses a couple of times. And I like to use a metaphor. I actually taken some down and moved them over, and when I bought them, they were built, so I had to take them apart. And I've put up hoop houses a number of times. And an interesting thing about a hoop house, when you're building a hoop house, the pile of metal you start with is like as long as these two tables. It's 1.5 feet tall, 2 feet wide, not a big pile of metal. When you get done putting all the metal together, it's 95 feet long, it's 30 feet wide, it's 15 feet tall. It's a really big structure that came from a little pile of pipe. And the act of putting the whole structure together requires simply a 9/16 and a half inch, right? A 9/16 socket and wrench for the bigger bolts and nuts, and a half inch socket and wrench for the smaller bolts and nuts, used over and over and over and over and over and over and over again to tighten all the bolts, to hold all the pipes together, to build the whole structure. Those few tools with those specific shapes used over and over again is all it takes to build this massive structure out of this little pile of ingredients. And as I understand it, that is very, those sockets, that 9/16 and the half inch socket or wrench, is very similar to an enzyme in its function in living systems, right? We use these sockets and wrenches and screwdrivers and Allen wrenches and star bits and square bits in mechanical systems to put things together and take things apart. These enzymes are those compounds which are used to do that exact job in living systems. When you are tying together amino acids to build a protein, you're literally screwing together the amino acids. The metaphor that's used for enzymes in school, if anybody remembers it from whenever it was, ninth grade or whenever, was a key that turns the lock. Something about that, people remember this? Vaguely, the key that turns the lock, and then the enzyme is the key that turns the lock. So basically, amino acids are these pipes, and the protein is the whole structure. And somebody's got to screw the pipes together to build the structure, and the enzyme is that compound that has the unique size that does the job of putting the pieces together, and then it's used again, and then it's used again, and then it's used again, and then it's used again. So what's exciting about this whole process of the minerals in chemistry as part of this larger conversation is each of these different elements has a different shape and size and shape, which puts it at the core of a different enzyme that's used for different jobs. And this is why it's so important to have that broad spectrum of elements present in the environment, is because these different jobs are critical for overall biological system function. If you are a car and your brake pads wear out, they are designed to be taken out and new ones put in. Is okay with that? If you're a car and your muffler busts out, your muffler is designed to have its old muffler taken out and a new one put in. If you're a human, your knee is not designed to be taken out and a new one put in. Right? Your liver is not designed to be taken out and a new one put in. If you're a human, you get 4 billion new cells every day. Every day, your body is identifying the oldest, junkiest cells and disassembling them, junking the parts that are unusable, and reassembling new ones. Every single day, 4 billion new cells are built in your body, whether you like it or not, against your will. It's part of your basic operating system manual. You are not designed to have pieces taken out and new pieces put in. You're designed to be constantly rebuilding yourself. If you do the math on how many cells you've got in your body, on average, you know, ballpark it all out, you get a new body every 6 months or so. Your bones take 7 years to replace themselves. Your blood takes 2 weeks to replace itself. But you get a new body on average every 6 months. So inside of every cell is a nucleus. Everybody knows this, you've heard about this. Inside every nucleus is DNA. Everybody's heard about this as well. DNA is a really, really big compound. People may have heard about this. So when you're building this really, really big compound, DNA, actually it requires a whole bunch of different enzymes to put the pieces together. You need a half inch and a 9/16 and a Phillips head and a flathead and three different Allen wrenches and two square bits and 14 star bits to build one strand of DNA. And each of those enzymes has a different element at the core of it. When they were performing the Human Genome Project, they were not only identified all the pieces of human DNA, but they also identified all the enzymes necessary to put the DNA together. And then when they've done that, they could easily identify all the elements at the core of those enzymes. You guys okay with this? Mm-hmm. Dozens of elements are required to replicate every strand of human DNA. Dozens of different elements: copper, zinc, manganese, cobalt, molybdenum, boron, vanadium, selenium, chromium. Go for a while. How many elements are required to balance a soil test according to Virginia Tech? Mm-hmm. When Virginia Tech gives you recommendations for fertility,
NPK,
calcium for pH or sulfur for pH, generally are the only recommendations you get. I don't know about Virginia Tech. I know about UMass. I know about UVM. I know about Cornell.
They used to do more. The trace minerals thing actually stopped. They ran out of budget.
And they ran out of budget, or
yeah,
who knows?
Budgetary decision.
At any rate, the question is, are we growing volume of crop, or are we growing food for humans? Where do we get these nutrients that our body needs to build itself from?
Our food.
They should be in our food. What does our fertility programs have to do with the nutrition of our crops? What is our job as farmers? Our job as farmers is to grow food, not to grow volume, not to grow bushels, not to grow bunches, but to grow nutrition, to grow flavor, to grow aroma, to grow health-giving attribute, as far as I'm concerned.
Well, ideally, they go, you're doing the flavor, the bushels.
But the priority is the nutrition, as far as I'm concerned.
So we're focusing.
Anyway, this is the whole conversation. This is the idea of the organization, is that we shift the conversation slightly to understand the importance of the nutrition itself as a, from a foundational standpoint. And so what happens when you don't have one of those dozens of elements present in the cell when the DNA is being replicated? Well, you don't have the enzyme. What happens when you don't have the 9/16ths when you need to tighten that nut? Or you get the, you get the vice grips out. Yeah, exactly. Functionally, that piece does not get put together. There's a word for that. You know what it's called when your DNA, when one piece of your DNA does not get put together properly?
Mutation.
A genetic marker, a mutation.
Mutation.
A break in the DNA. So we can identify specifically the mutations, the breaks in the DNA, with the enzymes that weren't present, with the element that was needed to build the enzyme. We can say categorically, chromium is responsible for the genetic markers that are correlated with diabetes. Categorically. End of conversation. We think diabetes is a disease that you need to manage for the rest of your life because it can't be cured, according to the doctors. Anybody heard of Hippocrates?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Hippocratic Oath? You mean on the Hippocratic Oath? First?
Yeah.
Then? Mm-hmm. Let food be thy medicine. And finally? Let me never be conned, tricked, or bought off into prescribing a poison. First, do no harm. No cutting, no slicing, no chemicals, no radiation. First, do no harm, then let food be thy medicine. Right? We've known this for a long time. We've known this, our humans have known for a very long time that, I mean, they don't know the science that you get 4 billion new cells every day and that you get these genetic markers and DNA and enzyme systems, blah, 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 blah. We know that if you eat well, your body will heal itself because your body is designed to heal itself. It's not a machine that you have to take pieces out of to replace. It's a living system which is designed to be maintained throughout. So this is part of the argument for the mineral balancing, for the seawater, for the copper sulfate and the cobalt sulfate and the boron and everything else, is that not only do our cells have enzymes that are needed to build compounds in them, but plant cells do, and so do bacterial cells, and so do fungal cells, and all of life actually uses the same enzymes for the same purposes, for the same compounds. It's remarkably similar. And if we want to build life in the system, we need to be looking in a broad spectrum at all these different components. You do not need much of these elements. I said 2 pounds of molybdenum per acre is enough to facilitate the fixation of all the nitrogen your crops will ever need. 2 pounds of molybdenum per acre. That's not a lot. That's one of the bigger quantities, right? That's one of the ones you measure. A lot of these we don't even bother measuring because you need so little. I mean, you need them, but you don't need that much. I never learned this as an organic farmer. I never learned this as an organic farmer, and the permaculturalists don't talk about it, right?
That's not true.
Do they now?
I do.
In general, the permaculture community, right, and the organic community now talks about it as well, but historically, traditionally, these communities have not integrated this understanding. As far as I'm concerned, this is a piece of the puzzle that people in these communities are very receptive to.
A lot of the context of the dynamic accumulators and supporting the micronutrients for nutrition.
Yeah. Conceptually, yes, perhaps. I shouldn't give the permaculturalists a bad time.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I'll take that back.
Water's life.
Anyway, the larger argument is still in place, and that is that we need these elements for life to function. And so that's the point I wanted to make about chemistry.
Didn't learn it from
the permaculturalists. They're receptive. They're good people, they mean well, when they're humble, and they say, oh, that makes sense, and I'm happy to use a little bit of seawater. Oh my God, look what happens when I do. They don't like to use things in bags that come from an industry in general. They push back against that, and so I say, we'll use your local rock dust. And then they don't complain anymore. That's been my experience as a permaculturalist. But biodynamic people, right, they're coming around to the idea that actually Steiner talked about the mineral realm as well as the etheric realm.
They're all frequencies of light.
Right.
Minerals are all crystal colors. If you go to a mineral shop, you'll see all the crystals and all the colors.
It's been great to introduce this conversation to the biodynamic community as well as to the organic community, because there's receptivity across the board. It's really exciting. When you frame these things well, we can actually begin to build alliances across the different streams in the movement. Anyway, I digress. Nothing out of the ordinary there. Physics. So vibration of the component pieces of matter sets up vibration of the whole is what I've got written here. I'm not sure what to do with that. Every mineral and compound has a frequency that affects every other aspect of the system. We talked, I think, a little bit about Alpha Centauri last time. Alpha Centauri being a star that's a long ways away, but we know exactly what's in it because of our reading of the vibration of the elements. Has anybody here ever been to an elementary school band concert?
Yeah.
Oh, yes.
Well, actually, we were so poor, we didn't have a band in elementary.
But you've been to an elementary school band concert?
Yeah.
Everybody's been to an elementary school band concert?
The lesson in dissonance, vibrations.
Right, is my point. It's very sweet, it's very endearing, and it really grates, right? I mean, it's just like...
It's just sell earplugs out.
It's really bad. I mean, they're so sweet, they're so cute, the instruments are bigger than they are, right? We know what a dissonant vibe is. Ever been to an a cappella choir, a beautiful, exquisite a cappella choir that was singing so beautifully and perfectly in tune that there's this thing called an overtone or a harmonic?
Yeah.
Right? There's four people singing, and there's five notes that you hear. Because the lower notes are in such perfect attunement that the fifth note is sounded.
Yeah.
We understand in chemistry that every element is a thing, that every compound is a thing. We understand in physics that every element is a vibration and every compound is a vibration. I would suggest that our bodies are made up of these things, which are vibrations, and that we each have a vibe. Everybody know what a vibe is? You gotten a vibe off of people? Right? You get vibes off of people?
Mm-hmm.
I find it really interesting how all these things overlay and correlate. And I would suggest that it was difficult for us to attune to our higher octaves, to our overtones, to our subtler natures, when our vibe is dissonant. When our bodies are vibrating out of tune because our compounds are not properly built, I would suggest that it becomes difficult for us to attuned to our guidance and to follow our higher nature. This is one of the foundational reasons behind my passion about this question of food quality. When I was in my 20s, I went off the metaphysical deep end and was very passionate about consciousness and God and truth and enlightenment, and was, you know, fairly dogmatic and arrogant and obnoxious about it. And at some point in my personal process, became aware of the fact that if people's bodies are vibrating out of tune, it will become it's very difficult for them to maintain the coherence, to maintain the attunement of higher consciousness. Mm-hmm. I understand that we are all eat food, that our bodies are built out of food, and I understand that if we don't have in our food those frequencies we need to vibrate coherently, then it will be very difficult for us to tune into our higher natures. So that's basically the point I want to make here about all these sciences, is I think there's an amazing correlation here between actually growing good food, which actually builds soil, which will actually sequester carbon, which will obviate the need for pharmaceuticals because we won't have these diseases, which will obviate the need for agribusiness chemicals. We don't need the fertilizers, we don't need the fungicides, we don't need the pesticides. Right? We don't need these compounds. Not only do we address a lot of these systemic issues through the process of growing good food, but we actually bring people's bodies into coherence, which I think will help them tune into their higher natures, which will help them be more in line with that guidance that comes from the higher octaves. I've got quantum mechanics here written down, and they say quantum mechanics is the topic, is the opportunity for people who don't know what they're talking about to say whatever they want, because... Mm-hmm. no one really understands what quantum mechanics means.
Right.
So I take that opportunity here, because I've written quantum mechanics on the slide, to talk about these things and hide behind the term. We've got these things called dark matter and dark energy. I'm sure people have heard about dark matter and dark energy, and you know, I think officially no one actually knows what they are, because the scientists, at least, we don't have the tools that can find them. Right? You know how this works? The tools that we have can see that there's something affecting what we can see, but they can't see what it is, because they're not operating in the right frequency range. Again, like we know, we have named somewhere between 3 and 5% of the species of life in the soil. We can find somewhere between 3 and 5% of the matter in the universe. Right? Most of the universe we can't find. Our telescopes, our microscopes, all of our tools, all the tools of science can find something like 3, 4, or 5% of reality. 95% of it, 96% of reality, 97% of reality, we can't find to look at. Our tools, I would suggest, are in the wrong octave. Like a piano keyboard, you've got low C and C and high C and high C. I would suggest that it's possible that there are octaves of frequency of reality, and that if we're looking on the physical plane with physical plane tools, we're only going to find the physical plane, and we need to use our tools which can perceive the higher planes, the higher octaves, if we want to find the rest of reality. I think it was Jesus that said that the body is a temple. People heard about this one? Is that a fair quote? The body's a temple?
Yeah.
A temple is a place where you go to pray, to commune to the divine, with the divine, right? If the body is the place where you go to commune with the divine, I would suggest that your body is the tool that can perceive the higher octaves of reality. And if your body is so dissonant, is so out of tune, that it can't hold the higher octaves, then it becomes very difficult for us to actually commune and operate from that higher level. So that's the basic point I want to make, is that this work of growing good food and eating good food, you know, can be framed from the perspective of we're solving global warming through carbon sequestration. It can be framed through we're obviating the need for agribusiness through growing healthy plants. It can be framed that we're helping the ecosystem by not polluting the aquifers and the waterways. It can be framed that we're helping with, you know, national security by preventing the national, you know, debt from becoming overwhelming because we're minimizing the healthcare costs. We can also be framed that we're doing, you know, God's work in helping people become more attuned to their higher natures. So what's exciting to me is that this food movement, which seems to be burgeoning, which seems to be really just sort of on all fronts, people are coming around to this question of food, and it's on for all these different reasons. We can use this food movement to help bring about all these different objectives. So that's really the central objective that I've got, and I just feel like I want to share it. So there I have. You can take it for whatever you like. Yes.
I wonder if you've given enough thought to the power of the mind to affect and change the chemistry of our bodies.
Yes. There's no question that our mind, as far as I'm concerned, our mind is operating from a higher frequency. And if you can maintain coherence in your mind, you certainly can affect reality on the physical plane. That's how Jesus did his miracles and everybody else, I think, because they had the coherence in the higher octave. The question is, how much control do you have of your mind? The question is, how powerful is your mind? And I think most of us would have to be honest about the fact that our minds are not very coherent, that we can't control our minds, that we can't fix and focus our minds. Some of us can, to some decent degree, but my understanding is that we're embarrassingly rudimentary in our capacities. There was a teacher that I have who, one of his aphorisms is, environment is stronger than willpower. Environment is stronger than willpower. And I would consider that our environment is our body, and that is stronger than our willpower of our mind to create reality. And I'm not saying one is stronger than the other, but my experience has been that I may intend well and mean well, but based on the circumstances around me, I will eventually sort of come into tune with them. And so from a strategic standpoint, I think that eating good food and building a body that's more coherent will simply help the mind become more powerful and the will and everything else become more powerful. I don't know. I just think it's probably not a bad idea.
From my background, I think there's probably 98 or 99% of what you say I can fly with.
That's enough.
One more.
Afterwards, we'll talk about what the 1% is. I'd love to hear it.
One more item. Jesus describes what he calls the heart, and out of the heart perceives the issues of life. And it occurs to me, after years and years of contemplation, that the heart is nothing much more than accumulation of our loves and hates. And it is the heart that drives the emotions. And it is the heart that is the furthest out of reach of our ability to intentionally change ourselves.
I'm not sure I would agree with that, but I would love to have a deeper conversation with you. Yes. I'm going to hold the conversation personal till later. So the rest of the handout here is what I call the seminal thinkers, and I unfortunately have not a hell of a lot of time to go into them all. So with as much depth as they deserve, I'll go quickly, and I have touched on some of them earlier. Mei Wan Ho, a woman of, I believe, Chinese descent, currently operating in the peak of her career in Great Britain, founder of the organization, the Institute of Science and Society, really, really interesting individual, among other things, has coined this term quantum jazz. She also has written a really good book about water, by the way. I think it's called The Rainbow and the Worm. But quantum jazz is her understanding of what goes on inside living cells as far as vibrations of compounds. And effectively what she says is that every time a new compound enters a cell with its vibration, every other compound in that cell, which is vibrating at this speed, which is 1 times 10 to the negative 14th of a second, which is pretty fast.
Yeah.
Every single other compound in that cell modulates its vibration like a jazz band to be in tune with that new element that, or compound coming into the cell. There's this constant modulation of vibration that's going on at this exquisite speed. This is actually how living systems operate. This is where biochemistry and biophysics become different from chemistry and physics.
Yeah.
Biochemistry and biophysics operate differently, and a lot of our physics that we've studied has not been in living systems. It's been this sort of straight abiotic physics. It's really quite interesting, the nuances of what's going on and the feedback loops. This helps me understand perhaps how the effect of me sitting and meditating in front of a zucchini plant has caused its leaves to expand dramatically overnight. Like how applying a foliar spray has caused 6 inches of new growth on every stem, on every plant, you know, in 3 days, with green leaves and bright flowers on plants that were almost dead. I have seen things occur on the physical plane through the application of small amounts of material or attention that have violated my understanding of what's possible. Absolutely violated my experience, my understanding. I've seen it happen with my own eyes, and what she talks about, the science of how things work in living systems, maybe is a window into how these things go on. Phil Callahan, recently departed, was a entomologist at the University of Florida in his professional career. As an entomologist, someone who studies insects, all of his work is classified by the U.S. military, which means we can't see it. One might ask why somebody who studies insects has their work classified, and the answer is because he was studying the antenna of insects. And the antenna of insects and how life has designed antenna is a very interesting question, and the military knows about studying nature and learning from nature. They understand that nature has already figured a lot of things out, and biomimicry is a really good idea. Phil Callahan, after he retired, was able to publish a couple of books where he would lay out thought experiments which conveyed some of the things that he was able to study but not able to publish. A couple of them I want to just quickly convey here. One of them talks about this whole question of pheromones. I'm sure people have heard about pheromones and how the female insect is flying through the night sky and she emits a pheromone, and the male insect from 2 miles away smells her and finds her, and they get to do what they do. One might ask, how much pheromone, which is basically, you know, a perfume, a female insect might emit in a night, and how strong the cloud must be for a male insect 2 miles away with no nose to smell it. Because insects don't really have very well-developed noses, and a 4-mile-wide diameter of aroma is a pretty significant amount of material for a small little insect to be emitting. And Phil Callahan said, silly people, always anthropomorphizing. Don't you understand? What insects have that is highly developed is not a nose, but an antenna system. And that compound in chemistry is a vibration in physics. And his antenna are tuned to the frequency of that compound. And all he's doing is hearing 88.5 coming in stronger from this direction than this direction and flying in this direction. It's really, really simple. And the only way, and you can test it by taking a male insect and putting it in one room and a female insect and putting it in the other room and seeing whether he flies towards her or not through the wall. Right? Can he smell her through the wall? Yes, he can. Because he's not smelling her, he's hearing her.
We've been finding bed bugs on this same issue with pheromones, happily not at my house.
Yeah. Very interesting man, Phil Callahan. This explains to me why it was that as a child I would see when the potatoes germinated, when we had rotated them across the street, 1,000 feet away from where they were last year, that up an inch and a half, all the potato bugs on the property were right on the potato plants. Right? Rotations are supposed to deal with this. I grew up on a farm. I noticed things. I noticed that I didn't see potato bugs anywhere else in the farm except where the potatoes were germinating, 1,000 feet away from where we planted them last year. They were right there. According to Phil Callahan, minor tangent. In the olden days, maybe I had one of these in their house.
Yeah.
Ever see one of those? It's not very well drawn. You get the gist? This is a thing on the physical plane, but it's actually vibrating, and the compounds that are in it, if it's full of nitrates, it's vibrating the frequency of a potato leaf full of nitrate. If it's full of protein, it's vibrating the frequency of a potato leaf full of protein. Guess which one the potato bug's antenna are tuned to? A potato leaf full of nitrate. That's the frequency their antenna are tuned to. It, according to Callahan, looks like neon light. Everything else is static, and that's neon light. Yeah. According to Phil Callahan, he tracked their how it works into their brains and the synapses all the way through. Nature's communicating through vibration, whether we like it or not, right? And this is what the indigenous communities are telling us, is that the plants speak to us, and they're using speak, you know, in a metaphorical. It's not like there's actual words, except depending on how sophisticated your antenna system are, it may come through to you as words, which moves us right along here. In a minute, we'll get there.
Can I just add one real quick thing?
Yes.
There's a number of different stuff you can read in the philosophy of language, and a lot of people working on the intersection of like animality studies and or critical animal studies and language. And one quick difference is the difference between speech and language. And so a speech act doesn't, the speech act I'm engaged in right now relies upon a shared grammar that I have with you. And we all have shared grammars with other animals that don't speak English. Mm-hmm. So your dog might not understand the word sit, but it understands a certain kind of tonality and a grammar that's very physiological and relies upon vibrations. And so people are taking this to the extent where they're now engaging with interspecies communication with relationship to plants, where they're extending
Absolutely.
This philosophy into that direction.
It's quite exciting. I'll get to Buhner in a second. And I've got Curvin on along the way. Louis Curvin, I think I referred to him yesterday. I talked about transmutation to some small degree. Louis Curvin, member of the French Academy of Science. I'll just give you a quick review of him. I don't have time for the full commentary. He began his professional career as working in the what was then called French Algeria on oil in the oil fields, which is now called Algeria. This is still the colonial period. His job was to monitor the oil workers, the black Africans who were working on the in the oil fields in the extreme conditions of 120 degrees temperatures, et cetera, to make sure that they didn't drop dead because it's bad economics to have your workers die on you. So his job was to monitor them and make sure that they are maintaining, hydration and, all these basic, levels so they could stay alive and keep working. And a part of what his job included was actually ashing all of the food that they were taking in and all of the excrement that was coming out of their bodies to monitor what was coming in, what was going on, going out, what the balances were, imbalances, et cetera. And as he was doing this work, he noticed that there seemed to be, I think it was more potassium going into their bodies than leaving their bodies, and more sodium coming out than going in. And potassium and sodium are electrolytes, and they're critical electrolytes. They need to be maintained at very specific levels in your blood for you to be, alive and function. And the imbalance was not large, but it was there, and it continued day after day as he continued this monitoring. At some point, he alerted his higher-ups, and they decided that it was potentially an issue because it had been going on for a couple of weeks now. It was extreme temperatures. Maybe something was going on. We didn't know what it was. Couldn't figure it out. Started, chopping them open and looking for the potassium deposits and where the sodium deficits were because they're black and it's okay. And, this is science. Couldn't find the potassium deposits. Couldn't find the sodium deficits. Sold them back up again. Process continued. The science kept telling them, the data kept telling them, mm-hmm. as they were ashing what was going in and what was going out, that there was more potassium going in and going out and more sodium coming out than going in. Finally, Curvin did his math a little bit differently. He didn't do the elemental analysis. He did the atomic weight analysis. And interestingly, there were as many atomic weights coming in as going out. They were just coming in one elemental form and leaving in a different elemental form. And Curvin was actually a scientist. He let his data guide him as opposed to letting his judgments and assumptions guide him, and said, well, data seems to be telling us this. This is very intriguing, and went on to have a very full career looking at other research from other countries and other people on other areas who were finding this very similar result, that in biological systems, as monitored, there seemed to be a shifting of atomic structure. There's various researches out there people may or may not have heard of. There's the simple experiment you can do with fertilized chicken eggs. You can do take 24 fertilized chicken eggs and ash 12 of them and get a mineral spectra as your baseline, and then incubate the other 12 for 21 days. And if you can bring yourself to, you can ash those 12 eggs that are about to hatch and get a mineral spectra on them. And you'll find there's significantly more calcium in those incubated eggs than there were in the simply fertilized eggs. We know about taking calcium out of a chicken's diet, and as long as they've got access to mica, they'll keep having shells on their eggs. But you take the mica away, and the calcium on the shells disappears. They'll just have the skin. There's no calcium in mica, but as long as you keep the mica in their diet, they'll continue to have shells. There's all kinds of data about this. It's really, really interesting. This actually explains, if you read his book, Biological Transmutations, the issue of isotopes. I'm not sure anybody has ever wondered about isotopes. There's carbon 12 and there's carbon 14. Some carbon has 14 atomic weights and some has 12. What's going on here? Why? Right. Well, because when they were making potassium out of sulfur, he lays it all out. It's very, very intriguing. It's very, very intriguing. But apparently, this only happens with biological systems. This does not happen in nature. In like abiotic systems, it doesn't happen in test tubes. We haven't found it in test tubes, so we don't think it's possible. And yet, our scientific tools can show us that this is happening. But because we haven't been able to do it, we think it must be flawed data. Very, very interesting. We have an annual conference for the BFA every year. And a couple of years ago, I was speaking, and we had brought in various speakers to cover different topics, and I was sort of batting cleanup, and what were topics that hadn't been covered yet, and I was like, I'll cover those ones. And so no one else had covered transmutation. people are afraid to talk about this for some silly reason. So I went out and, you know, gave my little shtick on transmutation. And afterwards, a young woman who was working on a farm, a local farm to where the conference was being held, came up to me and said, "You know, Dan, a lot of the things you guys are talking about makes a lot of sense to me, but when you start talking about things like that, I have to throw out everything you've said because I know this isn't true." And I said, "Have you bothered to do a Google search on transmutation?" She said, "No, it's not true." I said, "Well, before we continue this conversation, why don't you go home tonight and just type in biological transmutation and get back to me on what you find." And she came back to me the next morning and said the first thing that came up when I typed in biological transmutation was U.S. military research on biological transmutation. I had no idea. I said, that's the whole point. We don't have any idea. It's not in our school. It's not in our media. The science is there. The proper Western science is there to say things are going on we don't understand. This, as I understand it, is how bioaccumulator plants work. Bioaccumulator plants are actually making elements that are not present necessarily in the subsoil. We say, well, they got deep roots, and so therefore must be pulling it up from somewhere. Maybe, maybe not. I give you the example of the nettles yesterday and the boron. How does it all work? I don't know. Is it? The data seems to tell us it is true. I would suggest this is how nature balances soils. This is how you start with entirely different basic subsoils, entirely different basic paramaterials, and you end up with very similar topsoils across the planet. This is how it happens, I would suggest, is through biological activity. They're actually manufacturing this stuff.
It seems like part of our blindness is because of our philosophical basis in Greek thought that discards anything that might be called subjective.
Yeah.
We only want objective reality.
Yes.
We cannot tolerate subjective reality.
Yeah.
And all of these things are in that class that the Greeks thought were voodoo or something. I don't know what they thought it was.
Yes.
They would not allow it. And so this has come from German reasoning. This has come into America in our philosophical schools.
It's really interesting where exactly the blind spots are and what causes them. I don't quite understand it. That may be a logical philosophical position.
It's an underpinning of our whole scholasticism.
Yeah.
All of our educational theories are based in that Greek thought.
Yeah. And we can see the effect that that thought is having on the planet around us and, you know, our communities and our culture. At any rate, I would like to continue because I am definitely running out of time. Lynn McTaggart is an investigative journalist. She wrote a book called The Field. I think it was a little while ago now, in the late 90s, I believe. There's a couple more since then called The Intention Experiment and a few others. I have told the story. I have an interesting situation in my personal life where I have three cousins that are PhD neuroscientists. That is, you know, people that study the brain. Well, only one of them comes for Thanksgiving. The other two are from the Midwest. But when Audrey comes every year, I ask her about, because the Lynn McTaggart is, the book, The Field, is about cutting-edge insights in neuroscience. I asked my cousin Audrey, who was a PhD neuroscientist, have you guys found memories yet? And she has to answer every year, no, we haven't. People may not be aware of this, but neuroscientists have been trying to find memory for a long time, and they haven't found it yet. They have identified which parts of the brain are active when memories are occurring, but when they start chopping open the brain to figure out where the memories are and how they're stored, they're not there. Certain parts of the brain activate, but the memories are not stored in the brain like we have memories stored in a computer hard drive. What the cutting-edge neuroscientists seem to be saying, according to this book, is that they are stored in the field. And what is actually the field? Steiner of biodynamics referred to it as the Akashic Record, which is a Sanskrit term. But just let me explain to you as a basic conceptual framework here. If there was a pool of still water and I threw a rock into it, and any one of you came around the corner 5 seconds later and looked at the pool, you would be able to see what happened even though you didn't see it happen. Mm-hmm. Because you would have been able to see the waves that were caused by the thing that happened. And that's basically, as I understand it, effectively what the field is the field is all the waves that have occurred because of what has happened. And our brains are functionally not storing information, but they are antenna that are reading the field. This is what she's telling us in this work, which segues very nicely, as I understand it, into Buhner's work, Stephen Harrod Buhner's work, about our antenna systems. Functionally, the antenna in our brain are these neurons. Our neurons are these very long filamentous-like structures which, you know, pulse and turn and contract. And what Buhner is telling us is that actually our bodies are full of multiple organs that are full of these neurons. It's not just our head that is a brain. Actually, technically, interestingly, we have multiple organs full of our that are full of neurons. Our heart is full of neurons. Our gut is full of neurons. And women have a fourth brain. Let me know what it is. What's that? No, we literally have a fourth organ full of neurons. The uterus. The uterus is full of neurons as well, which is technically means that women have four brains, which is why they're smarter than men, which is why they should stop giving us a hard time. Just stop giving us a hard time. You've got four brains, we've got three, you shouldn't expect as much out of us. Stop giving us a hard time.
We also have one for seven.
You're on even playing level. Once you've had a hysterectomy, you're down to our level.
That's why she's straight to the point. She's like,
when you have a gut feeling about something, anybody ever heard a gut feeling about something? You know it in your gut. Somebody can lie to you, they can talk fast, but you know in your gut. Every know something in your heart? You know it in your heart. We have it in our vernacular. We make our life decisions based on that read we get of reality through our antenna system. When you have a heart feeling about something, when you know something's true in your heart, the logic and everything else doesn't really matter anymore because you know something. Those knowings are what guide our life decisions. We act on this throughout our life, and we don't talk about it. We don't talk about it, right? When you've got a gut feeling about something, I want to do this. I don't know why, I just know. Like, we are hardwired with the antenna to perceive reality, to communicate with reality, to engage reality. As I understand it, this is our antenna system. Plants have their antenna system. Insects have their antenna systems. We have evolved to communicate through frequency, and if we could
get out of our own way to listen, some of us are better at it than others, it would be much, much more simple, everything we're up to. Anyway.
What about the PBI?
TBI.
Traumatic brain injury.
Yeah.
And how that may affect your memory. So.
Yeah.
There's some sort of connection with your brain and memory, though.
Absolutely, there's a connection. I don't know. I mean, I haven't
if
read
it's
this
the
book
antenna,
recently.
You have
a loose antenna.
You have, yeah.
Think about it. If someone comes
screw it back
your
in.
With a bat, it's not gonna work.
I don't know. I haven't looked into this in depth. This is the argument that's made, and what I've been trying to piece together is some basic research which looks at this stuff from a scientific mode, which ties together an alternate reality, which correlates with what traditional human cultures across time and space have all been telling us. Again, I go back to this point about the anthropologists. When you've got 14 data points in the same spot and one over here, maybe those 14 are onto something. And if we look in the Western scientific literature, we can find explanations that justify where they're coming from. We can use our model of understanding to trust or tune into or feel or accept that which is being taught to us, which we are not open to because that's not what we've been told. And that we start off with what we've been told, and then that's our foundational assumptions. So. Let's use the Western scientific system to investigate this question, as my suggestion. And, you know, where's the argument there? Anyway, it's very intriguing. I find it very compelling, and I just like to put it out there for people who are curious. Ulrey, I talked about Ulrey's work with the DNA and the Human Genome Project. Wilhelm Reich, I'm officially out of time. I have about 6 or 8 more slides. I'll try to be fast, but those who have to leave have to leave. Wilhelm Reich was a student of Freud's. He and Jung were two of Freud's sort of protege students. Wilhelm Reich, my wife learned about in ninth grade science class because she grew up in India, and Wilhelm Reich was the first Western scientist to formally isolate and prove the existence of what they call in India prana, what they call in China qi. He called it orgone or bions. Very, very interesting fellow. He was locked up by the FDA. His books were burned. He died in jail in suspicious circumstances. There's an annual meeting of the International Society of Orgonomy in Rangeley, Maine, where he lived. I had the experience of perceiving directly, which I think fits the description of what he called bions, which fits the description of what the yogis call prana. I haven't studied the Chinese literature very well, but it might fit the description of what they call qi. I wanted to sort of give you a couple descriptions here and see if anybody knows what I'm talking about. For starters, before we get to prana, has anybody ever been in the middle of a field and looked at the tree line and seen above the green of the trees and below the blue of the sky a little white line? It's about an inch tall, looks like.
No.
Try it sometime. Growing up on the farm, I spent a lot of time outside, wishing I wasn't in the middle of the field working. But I remember always seeing above the green of the trees and below the blue of the sky this white line. Well, not a line, it's like a thick white space. And I'm just like, it's always there, I can't get it out, what is it? And it fits the description of a aura, I believe. But it's always there. What is this white thing above the trees that I can't get out of my eyes? It fits the description of an aura exactly.
The camera doesn't pick it up.
Just as a coincidence. Anyways, you guys don't get much snow down here. My experience on a sunny morning after it snowed, going outside into the bright light of the sun, is that I look at the snow, I see these little things spiraling around that are, they're translucent, they're not there, but I can see like the edges of them spiraling. Does anyone know what I'm talking about? These little things you see spiraling sometimes in the...
I thought it was my
eyes. Yeah, you think it's your eyes, but you see it. In the late afternoon, if you're out in the backyard and the trees are a ways away and you're focusing your eyes like 15 feet away into the sky, like focus like you were looking 15 feet away, but there's nothing there, just sky. I see these same things spiraling around in the sky. You don't see it in the city. You see it up in the mountains. You see it in places where you can smell fresh air. These little things that spiral around, they do this, they spiraling motion. I see them when I'm riding in an airplane. I look out the window of the airplane. They're always outside the window of an airplane. I don't know what it is, except it fits the description of prana and orgone and qi, according to Wilhelm Reich. I want to put it out there. Take it for what it's worth.
I asked somebody about that, and they told me that was little particles on my eyeballs.
Yeah. That all spiral really fast in the same direction.
Yeah.
Just a coincidence. Read Wilhelm Reich's work. Interesting. Very, very interesting.
Well, there is a Taoist term for that called Shih, S-H-I-H.
Yeah.
Which is propensity energy, in the system.
Yeah. I mean, I would argue that our body is the tool by which we can perceive the multiple octaves of reality. That we have this, the meridians, we have the nadis, we have the chakras, we have actually cultures which are much older than ours, which are very scientific in their orientation, which have laid out a subtle anatomy and structure and said, look guys, this is how it works. Cause and effect, do this, get this result, do this, get this result. It's scientific, it's just metaphysics, not just plain physics, right? Our science is physics, is the physical plane. There's a metaphysics of the other octaves. And the argument is, this is why I'm talking about Jesus saying the body is a temple, is that our tool for perceiving that reality is this body, which we inhabit. We are not the body, we are that which inhabits the body. And the body is our tool for perceiving that reality and engaging in that reality. This is my larger argument. I hope I'm not coming across too strongly. I apologize if I am. Rudolf Steiner, the founder of biodynamics, as well as a couple of other interesting schools of thought, actually himself did have a background in the esoteric. He was brought up in the theosophical tradition, which is one of the Western mystery schools, very powerful in his day in the late 1800s. Theosophists were competing with the chemists in England to identify the structure of matter. People don't know this story. but you can look it up in the newspapers in London in the late 1800s. The theosophists were sitting down and meditating and looking at copper and seeing the structure of copper and then drawing it up and publishing it. And then a month later or a year later, the chemists would identify the structure of copper and publish it. And lo and behold, the theosophists beat the chemists on, you know, 35 elements or something. I'm not sure the exact number, but dozens of elements. The theosophists figured out their structure first before the chemists and published it in the newspapers. Steiner grew up in this community, now Blavatsky and Besant, at any rate. Steiner is one who I have not studied sufficiently well to speak really coherently about him. There are some people in the biodynamic community who follow closely the moon signs and talk about the effect of subtle forces in the environment. Again, we talk to indigenous communities around the planet, and they're very categorical about when you should plant and when you should harvest and when you should do other things based on where the moon is. And it's, you know, and functionally, there's a woman named, what's her name? In Germany.
The one who does the calendar?
Radishes. Maria Thun. Yeah, Maria Thun, who did research planting 30 radish seeds every day and watching to see how they grew. I'm not sure anybody's ever, again, as growing up on a farm, my experience was sometimes we'd plant radishes and they'd all go to seed. And sometimes we'd plant radishes and they'd all grow big leaves. And every now and then we'd plant radishes and they'd actually grow big roots. Anybody had this experience? Every now and then?
They grow radishes, different.
Sometimes they grow roots.
I'm not watching the moon, is that it?
The whole point is
that
when the moon is sometimes in front of a constellation which projects, the moon functions according to this whole, you know, paradigm. The moon functions like a magnifying glass, and it magnifies different energies as it passes through around. In so what we call an earth sign, you know, what's an earth sign? Taurus? Is Taurus an earth sign? When the moon is in front of Taurus, it's magnifying the earth sign energy, and that's when you plant your root crops because the root aspect is accentuated. When the moon is in front of what we call a water sign, that's when the leaf growth is accentuated. When the moon is in front of what we call a fire sign, that's when the fruit growth is accentuated. And this is what Maria Thun documented on her farm, and there's a whole calendar which lays this all out for you. Very, very interesting.
What about
air? Air is the seed, is herbs, flowers and herbs, and seed. Yeah.
So you plant things that you want to go to seed?
When you are planting things that you want to have strong aromatic qualities, or flowers, or seed crops, you plant them on an air sign. Aries is a fire sign. There's a really simple calendar you can buy for $13. I buy the one that comes out of Pennsylvania called the Stella Natura. And you can look this all up online. It interestingly happens to coordinate with what communities of people from around the planet without talking to each other have all come to. Just saying, if we're scientists and we're looking at data points, there's certain things that cultures pay a lot of attention to and feel strongly about who never talk to each other. And this is one more of those things that we as good Western rational skeptics are like, pfft,
right.
Baloney. And yet, if we want to be honest, we want to be scientists, we want to be Western rational thinkers, if we want to, you know, engage in science properly and not be dogmatic, we need to look at the data and think logically about it, if we want to engage it that way. We could say intuitively, boy, that makes sense, I'm going to go for it, I don't care, which is what some of us do. But I can engage the Western rational mode if I so choose. Anyway, minor point on this, not minor. One of Steiner's students named, what's that? Aaron Reed Pfeiffer, thank you. Yes, Pfeiffer, who's one of the people who brought biodynamics to North America. I guess a picture of him holding you as a baby. Is that the story I heard?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's a story I heard.
Yes. Just confirming. Pfeiffer asked Steiner, why is it that when we sit down to meditate, sit down to pray, I talked about this yesterday, didn't I? Why can't we maintain that state of consciousness when we're when we get up to go about our life? And Steiner said, because our food does not have enough soul force. Our food does not have enough soul force. So this goes back to my argument a minute ago with consciousness and our ability to hold higher consciousness and the nature of our food and the quality of our food. I truly do believe that there's something here. I'm not saying I know what it is, but I think there's something here. Mollison and Holmgren and permaculture, I think I've respected permaculture sufficiently. It deserves great respect. The insight about polycultures and about the full spectrum of species present, the perennial aspects, the microbiology, the minimal tillage, the importance of water. There's so much that permaculture has to offer and integrate into our understandings about how to work well with the land. I think truly the best permaculturalists were those indigenous cultures which were managing the whole landscape as the Native Americans were and as others were historically as well. We've got a system now from white people that comes in books which trains you, for those who are curious, called permaculture, which really, you know, operates from a lot of these deeper insights. I don't have time to go into it in depth. Kerry Reams, again, unfortunately don't have time to go into depth on him. He, I believe, also was a clairvoyant and perceived things directly. He was a, you know, not. I talked about Reams yesterday. I don't think I need to talk about him too much more. I'll just say one thing here. If your plants are not flowering and fruiting, little trick, if they're like eggplants are not flowering and fruiting, they're just growing but not flowering, you can apply what Reams would have called female elements. I've got written down here phosphorus and manganese. I believe those are what he called the most strongly female elements. And you should expect to see a female reproductive response, which is the flowering of the crop. If you have lettuce that you are afraid is going to go to seed, which would be a female response, and you want to have a strongly male energy effect, put the male, you know, finger on the scale, that would be calcium and potassium. So you can apply calcium and potassium to keep things from going to seed. You can apply phosphorus and manganese to force things to go to seed. Not that you should, but there's, once you understand the spin and the energy of these different elements, you can use them as necessary to modulate reality around you. Quickly, again, anybody who's aware of the concept that when you spend too much time talking on your cell phone, it hurts your brain. You shouldn't be in the presence of Wi-Fi, you know, sitting in front of a photocopier or a microwave is bad for you. It's aware of this concept called EMF, electromagnetic frequencies, dissonant electromagnetic frequencies. As I understand it, remember that in the 90s, the ad, this is your brain on drugs, yeah, with a frying pan with a raw egg in it and a fried egg. My understanding is this is your brain on EMFs, that actually electromagnetic frequencies, these things, cell phones, wireless, computer wireless, et cetera, fry the protoplasm in our cells like an egg, literally fry it. That's why your brain hurts if you spend too much. The side of your head, anybody? Right in here? I feel it and it hurts.
Yeah, I have to unplug things.
My children won't sleep if we don't unplug the wireless.
They're about 100 times what they were 125 years ago.
It's real
and
bad.
Now they're about, before cell phones, and now they're probably about 1,000 times what we evolved with.
I can't sleep in the city. I go to the city to speak, and I open up my computer, and there's like 85 wireless signals all overlapping. Right? You wonder why people in the city can't sleep? You wonder why they're all like wired? They can't hold a coherent thought? Right? Anybody? City people? Sorry. Is there any city people here? Probably not the city people here, because you guys are all holding coherent thoughts. No, seriously. Like, you try to go have an intelligent conversation, and this is... Anyways, my understanding is that we are, as antennas, and our plants, as antennas, are being affected by this background dissonant frequency, and it's really messing us up. The idea here is that, yes, this is part of reality, and if we can project dissonance, then we should be able to project coherence, right? A corollary is we can project coherence. And so I've got written down here the term cosmic pipes. I've got three names, Galen Hieronymus, Hugh Lovell, Bruce Tainio, people who have designed tools that can be used, plugged into the ground, plugged into your electric socket in your house, that can project coherence into a area. Very, very interesting topic. I don't have enough confidence to say this works this way, this works that way, this one's a good deal, that one's a scam, but the idea here is that if we can project dissonance, we can project coherence, if we are antenna, if life is antenna, if life is projecting through frequency, then this that's going on is actually dramatically affecting us and life around us. And we should take responsibility, at least for our energetic space, and work to project coherence in it. Yes?
We go in a cave, we feel completely different.
Yep. How well does your cell phone work in the cave?
if there's no cell phones in there.
We sense these things. When the power goes out?
In the absence of, yep.
Anybody ever been around the house when the power's out? Like, what's your quality of sleep like?
You can take a fluorescent light bulb, mm-hmm, and walk it under some of these high power lines. And
it lights right up. I did that in like a fourth grade science experiment. Yeah. Take a fluorescent light bulb and walk underneath the power lines.
We live near one of these power lines in New Hampshire, and we could walk under this thing and our bodies would feel different.
When it rains, you can hear it.
Yeah. There were times when our hair, in the cold winter, yep, our hair going under these power lines would begin to stand up.
Yeah. So, laying it out there, we're past time. I don't really have anything else to say except this is part of reality as I understand it. I think it's part of the larger conversation. Water, Masamarimoto, Messages from Water. Brilliant book if you've read the book. Brilliant movie if you've seen the movie. This guy was a Japanese researcher who would take tap water, put it into vials, say to one vial, I love you, and say to the other vial, I hate you, and put those two vials in the freezer. And then when they froze, he'd take them out and take a picture of the crystalline structure and see beautiful snowflake shapes over here and totally amorphous blobs over here.
Did different languages.
Absolutely, totally interesting. Then didn't say anything, just wrote it on a piece of tape and put it on there. Really interesting. We talked about water yesterday. I said I don't know what water is. I think it's really, really interesting. We talked about irrigation lines. We talked about the heart and spin. I don't really have a lot more to say about water except that it's really, really interesting, and not all water is equal. And you know, if we can figure out ways to work intelligently and thoughtfully to put structure and coherence into our irrigation water, I bet it'll help our plants. So I'll leave that there, because I really don't have a lot to offer except that it's really interesting. The last two slides I've got here are seawater and rock dust. I want to just reiterate what I said earlier, which is that I think that we can do an amazing amount with things we have in our immediate environment to revitalize the land. And if we want to work most efficiently, helping to address mineral deficiencies, I think is strategic. And in some cases, we can't get those minerals immediately or readily from our immediate environment. But I think with rock dust and seawater, we have everything that we need to remineralize this planet. I truly do believe that we can turn this planet from brown to green. I truly do believe that we can build soil and create the foundational environment for humanity writ large to have a much more harmonious existence. And that's my desire, my intention, and you know, my hope with this work, with this organization, and around this country. So I wish you all luck in the process of, you know, building soil and growing healthy plants. And if it's true, it'll work. And if it works, I hope it'll spread. So I think that's about all I have.